Hi, everyone, and welcome to Queens Public Library's New York's Ocean Wonder, Hudson Canyon. I'm Lynn from the Children's Library Discovery Center at the Central Library and also the Hunters Point Library Environmental Education Center. A little bit of library news before we get started. Today is Queens Public Library Day, the finishing up celebration for our 125 years of service to our Queens community. Keep checking queenslibrary.org for giveaways and more. And a giveaway today and in the next several days at the Central Library in Jamaica. There are booklets of 125 things to do in Queens. And during our celebration of Women's History Month, Queens Public Library honors the leadership, strength, and power of all individuals who identify as women. We salute our trailblazers who, thanks to their determination and hard work, have made significant contributions to Queens and opened a world of opportunities for generations to come. Learn more about our celebrations at queenslib.org/WHM2022. And of course, tax season is here. Queens Public Library has compiled a resource list of partner organizations who can provide you with virtual tax help this year. Visit our blog on queenslibrary.org for more information. And try BrainFuse Help Now, which offers live online tutoring homework help every day from 2 to 11 p.m. An adult learning center program, a 24-hour writing lab, and more. Visit queenslib.org/BrainFuse to access this online service. And today's program is one of many for the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center. We hope you'll join us next Saturday, also at 2 p.m. here on YouTube Live, for ecology and birding in Long Island City waterfront parks. We're going to have a couple of our neighbors from Hunters Point with us that day. Be sure to check the comments, as we'll be adding links for these events and more. You can set reminders. And we hope that you'll be adding comments and questions for our presenter. We love hearing from our audience. These programs are made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by the City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. And I am so pleased to introduce our guest today, Dr. Mary Cammy. She is director of the New York Seascape Project. And she has worked in marine conservation since receiving her PhD in ecology from Rutgers University, where she studied sea turtles in Costa Rica and Georgia. She then worked at National Audubon, focusing on domestic and international conservation and management of large ocean fishes, especially sharks. And she has served as a consultant on a wide variety of conservation and education projects and was content coordinator for the American Museum of Natural History's exhibition, Water, H2O Equals Life. Her publications include a co-authored report on the conservation status of pelagic sharks and rays and co-edited book, Sharks of the Open Ocean. And now let's say hello to Mary. It's all yours, Mary.
Thank you so much, Lynn. Hello, everybody. I'm Mary Camhai. As Lynn mentioned, I am the director of the New York Seascape Program, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that in just a moment. And I'm going to take you a little bit on a tour of New York. And I'm assuming most of you in the audience are New Yorkers or native New Yorkers like myself. And so this is as much almost of a personal journey as it is one where I'm hoping to teach you a little bit about our own backyard. So I'm going to get started and tell you a little bit about where, about my program and about the organization that I work for. So many of you may have heard of the Wildlife Conservation Society. It is the, we have been in New York City, based in New York City since 1895. And most of you probably know it because of the fact that we all oversee five of the parks, the city's parks and zoos, right? We have the Central Park Zoo, the Queens Zoo, the Prospect Park Zoo, and our two flagships, the Bronx Zoo in the Bronx, and then also the New York Aquarium. So most people in New York know us from that perspective, but I want to tell you a little bit about the work that WCS, as Wildlife Conservation Society, does conservation all around the world. We are one of the largest conservation organizations, international conservation organizations. We work in 60 countries on elephants, on tigers, on many, many different species, protecting species from extinction as well as their habitats. And one of the places that we're working is right here in New York. And I'm going to tell you a lot more about that in just a moment. We do marine conservation in 23 of those places. And in most of those places, it's in tropical waters. So we're one of the few places where we actually work in a temperate zone like here in our own backyard. So my presentation is going to focus on first telling you about the New York Seascape, where we are, what's here, and why it's so special. We'll take a little bit deeper dive then into the Hudson Canyon, a very important place in our local waters, and hopefully inspire you to want to even learn more. And then I'll tell you a little bit about what we're doing to actually protect this this ecological gem. All right, so that's sort of a little bit of the outline of my talk. All right, so here we go. What is the New York Seascape? Some of you may have heard the term the New York Bight before. A bight is an oceanographic structure that's sort of like is represented by a bend or an elbow in our coastline. All right. Our seascape is what we call the waters, my turf or surf, I should actually say, that we help to protect and focus our energy, our conservation energy science and policy around, includes all the waters. It's about 25,000 square miles from the point from Montauk, New York, right, to Cape May, New Jersey, from the tidal rivers, including like the Bronx River, all the way out to the edge of the continental shelf, and then Long Island Sound, a really big patch of ocean. And so that's the New York Seascape when I speak to you about that and say it, you know, tell you more about it. And not because a lot of people do not know much about the seascape and don't understand how important these waters are. A number of years ago, WCS and my program had an opportunity to work with the National Geographic Society to develop this wall map. It's actually an award-winning wall map. And you'll see here on the bottom, there is a link to it. You can actually see it for yourself online, and I think maybe we'll be able to put that in the comments as in the chat or comments as well. And if you happen to be a teacher and you're interested in getting a copy of this, please reach out. We actually have hard copies as well. And I'm going to show you that it's actually a dual-sided map. So I'm going to show you in a few minutes what's on the other side. But the idea here is to show students, adults, everybody, anyone around the world, why New York waters are so important. These are very busy waters, historically important, but yet still full of life. All right, so I'm going to tell you a little bit more about that. Now, I know most of us and most of you probably don't know about what's happening at the water's edge. And for that matter, you know, I'll be perfectly frank. I grew up in New York City. I was born in the Bronx. I spent most of my life going to school and raising my own little pups in New Jersey. Then I moved to Long Island. So my whole life, I've been living on one side of the Hudson or the other. And I've been doing marine conservation for decades now. It wasn't until I actually started with the New York Seascape Program, which I helped establish in 2010, that I really came to understand are how important our waters are. So as Lynn mentioned, I did sea turtle research, and I in the tropics, I did shark policy work all around the world. And it seemed to me that when I went into conservation, the ocean was always bluer on the other side of the planet, right? There was always some other place to protect, to save, that was full of life. And it wasn't until I started this program that I actually came to understand how amazing our local waters are, right? So here you go. These are, when people think of New York, and including ourselves, we think of the hustle and bustle, the traffic, the pollution, the culture, the built structure, the metropolis that's here, right? Very few people actually think a bit in natural terms. And to be frank, our ocean, our local waters, is among the most urbanized ecosystems in the world, right? 22 million people live along the coastline I just described to you, from Montauk to Cape May. This is probably among the most important, largest, and one of the most economically important ports in the world, and certainly here in the US. We depend on these waters, and have for millennia, long past even Henry Hudson's sailing into the harbor. These waters have been a source of life and sustenance for people for thousands and thousands of years. And every year we're putting more and more pressure on our local waters, right? So part of our mission at the New York Seascape is to figure out, how do we ensure a safe place for marine wildlife in these increasingly busy waters? Now, I'm showing you a picture. If you look up here, I don't know if you, oh, I'm sorry, I'm going to go back a second. I don't know if you can see my pointer, but in the upper left-hand corner, you'll see an image that came out of a very famous book. If you're interested in learning about historical ecology of New York, Manahatta by Dr. Eric Sanderson is a phenomenal book. This is a depiction of what we think Manhattan Island looked like in prior to Hudson sailing into the New York Harbor. Right, it was wild. There were bears and wolves and all kinds of animals roaming the streets, right, of New York. Over the last 400 years, all of that is gone, right? All that wildlife now has really been reduced to what people think of New York City wildlife as rats and cats, and definitely a tremendous amount of birds in places like Central Park, but it's not what it once used to be. Now, I want us to think differently about New York. I want us to think of it so not so much as a metropolis, but more as an aquapolis. And why do I say that? Because aqua is water, and we are a city of islands, or an archipelago that is totally surrounded by water, right? And in that water, there is so much life. So much life, all right? So let's try to change our mindset a little bit to think about New York as a place that's full of, is surrounded by salty seas and is full of life. Now, that was the cityscape, but if you were to just maybe paddle out 10 miles, maybe even less, from the harbor or from, Jamaica Bay, this is what you would see. You would see basically a blanket of blue. Right, this, and it looks like an expanse of almost emptiness. A lot of times, that's the way we think of the water. But if we could actually peel back that layer of ocean and look below, I think all of us, including me, as I mentioned before, living my whole life here, did not have any sense about how amazingly diverse our local waters are. Right, so most of our terrestrial wildlife has been displaced, extirpated, et cetera. In the last 400 years, we have not been able to document any extinction of any marine animal that uses our water, calls our water home. Now, they're only here for some of the year. It's a very seasonal movement of fish and birds and marine mammals and turtles in and out of our seascape, but still critically important habitat. You can get an idea here of how many different species we've been able to document locally, including many sharks. Nobody knows we share our waters with sharks, even in New York Harbor. These include some of the fastest animals in the world, like a Mako shark, some of the most ancient creatures like sea turtles and horseshoe crabs, some of the largest like blue whales and humpback whales, etc. And we even have things like corals in our water. Now, they're not tropical corals, they're cold water corals, and these actually are called the Hudson Canyon, their home. That's where we find collections of coral colonies. All right, so that's to just give you a little idea about how amazing our local waters are. Now, in WCS, as I mentioned, has been doing conservation work around the world since the late 1800s, but it wasn't really until 2010 that they decided to turn our attention to right here, our own backyard, right? The waters that lap the shores of this amazing city, our Aquapolis. And we established the New York Seascape program. And WCS is very much of a science-driven, science-based organization. So part of our work is to actually do research, to do science in order to understand local biodiversity and fill information gaps that would allow us to start to protect wildlife, right? And part of our work, we do a lot of policy work relating to restoring threatened species, protecting critical habitat, throughout the seascape. And then the other really important part, and maybe the most important part ultimately, is that we seek to inspire a New York ocean ethic. So New York may be the world's leader in so many things, culturally, economically, et cetera. But when it comes to ocean awareness, we are not. We lag behind places like Boston, Seattle, and San Francisco. And our goal is to try to reconnect New Yorkers back to the ocean and help them understand how amazing this place is, inspire them to become stewards of this great place. And we do it through research, policy, and education outreach. Now, as I mentioned, part of our job is raising awareness. And so the other side of that that map that I showed you, the New York Seascape map, the one that we've done in conjunction with National Geographic, shows this image. This image is a depiction of some of the wildlife that exists in various habitats throughout our seascape. Right from all the way from the tidal rivers out to the Hudson Canyon, the edge of the continental shelf, to give folks an idea of the diversity and the both structural in terms of habitat and marine wildlife that we are working to protect. And we also, as I mentioned, conduct research. So I don't know how many of you may be familiar with the term diadromous fish. These are fishes that actually come into spend part of their life in freshwater and part of their life in saltwater. And if you're familiar at least with salmon from the Pacific Northwest, you know that they spend their time in the ocean, but when it's time to reproduce and breed, they come into freshwater rivers where they lay their eggs and eventually die. Well, we have 14 different kinds of diadromous fishes in New York. And in the one freshwater river that we have here, which is the Bronx River, we have a number of really important species, including the American eel and another one called alewife herring. These are really important species that move in and out of freshwater and saltwater to complete their life cycles. And one of the studies we were doing is looking at, this is the dam, the first dam on the Bronx River at 182nd Street. This dam is 13 feet high and keeps all these fishes and a lot of other wildlife from being able to move into habitat that they depend on for reproducing or to grow into maturity. So what we've been doing is studying how dams affect wildlife there. And if I ever want to come back, ever want to invite me back, I would love to tell you the story about this creature, slimy, creepy. A lot of people don't like them. They've become one of my favorite animals, the American eel. They have a phenomenal life history story that when I tell it, it even gives me chills. The other thing at species, we also work on sharks, as I mentioned. Lots of sharks in our waters, including right here, down the street from me, I'm on Long Island in the bays. Sharks, we share these waters with sharks, have been forever. And, you know, this is their habitat. So we are looking at their movements and their dependency using things like acoustic tags that are internal tags and satellite tags like you see here, so that we can track their movements around New York waters. And then we're also studying whales. We have at least 15 species of whales or marine mammals in our waters, including the most endangered, one of the most endangered on the planet, the North Atlantic right whale, passes through here, along with humpback whales. And we have monitors out in the middle of the harbor that actually listen to the songs that that whales are and the communication that they are making, and actually records them. And you can actually go online and observe what whales have be heard, can be heard on different days in local waters. And we're doing lots of other research, but that just gives you an idea of the local research that we're doing in support of conservation. Now, canyons. We're going to talk a little bit about canyons, right? Some of you may recognize this and you might think, what's that? That's not Hudson Canyon. And you would be absolutely right. This is a picture of the Grand Canyon, probably one of the best known canyons maybe in the world, right? And I wish I were able to present to you a similar kind of image as we have here for Hudson Canyon, because it was these kinds of images that inspired folks to actually go out and protect this area as a national park, right? So images are really important. But I can't show you what the canyon actually looks like, because that canyon is buried very far beneath the between the ocean, below the ocean surface. And we'll talk a little bit about that, the nature of the canyon, in just a moment. But I wanted to start by at least talking a little bit about what a submarine canyon is. And Hudson Canyon is a submarine canyon. It is actually the largest canyon along the eastern seaboard, the Atlantic seaboard. And you can see here from Maine to just to Delaware, we have 14 major canyons that occur right at the edge of the continental shelf, right? Hudson is the largest of that grouping, and actually one of the largest in the world. So New York, we've got it. We've got one of the most important, largest and canyons, which is really an ecological gem. It's a hotspot. So a little bit just about what a canyon is and how it's formed. As it turns out, the Hudson Canyon is the drowned riverbed of the Hudson River. So 10,000 years ago, when the glaciers were just ice, we had ice all the way about 50 miles out from where our shore is now, it was much higher. As the glaciers retreated and the water was melting, it was carving the Hudson Canyon, or at least the Hudson River gorge, right? This is this area. Where that carving meets the edge of the continental shelf, it dives deep into, you can see how steep this is here, and cuts or incises the edge of that continental shelf. All right. So it is the drowned riverbed that's been carving over millennia, a pathway that takes water draining into the Hudson River and all the way down, as well as from our coastlines, all the way down into the canyon itself. So a couple of superlatives about the canyon. It is absolutely an amazing place. The canyon proper starts about 100 miles from where you're sitting right now, right? From the aquariums or the Empire State Building. It's southeast of the city. And from there, it actually goes out and extends, as I pointed out here, goes down the edge of the continental shelf, but out into the flats of the ocean, right? For another 350 miles. So it's hundreds of miles long. At its widest point, it's over seven miles wide. There are hundreds and hundreds of species that call this area home. And the reason why it is so ecologically important is because of the hydrology of the system, that the nature of a canyon creates, and thermal differences, winds and currents create movement of water and nutrients. There are upwellings that bring a lot of water, a lot of nutrients to the surface, and that helps to attract and concentrate a lot of wildlife there, right? So it's a lot of different structure, a lot of nutrients, a lot of and a lot of life that tend to all accumulate around that area. At the deepest point, it's over 10,000 feet. So if any of you are familiar with the height of, let's say, the Empire State Building, I guess, is one example. You'd have to stack 7 Empire State Buildings on top of each other to get to the depth of the canyon. Or if you looked at the parachute jump, I'll show you in a little bit of an image, 42 parachute jumps at Coney Island stacked on top of each other. That's how deep it goes. All right. So it is a seasonally important, lots of temperature changes that bring species in and out over the season, but hundreds and hundreds of animals occur there. Some of them bizarre, like wolf fish, some of them really important, like squid for our local seafood and fisheries, and also lots of birds, lots of whales, et cetera, that can support ecotourism. All right, sorry about that. So we're really just beginning to learn right now a lot about the canyon. We're collating a lot of information because we want to protect it. But the canyon was first discussed and brought to public awareness around 1925. Now, I don't know how many of you have heard of William Beebe. He was a New Yorker. He was born in Brooklyn. He lived his whole life here. And he actually was one of the earliest directors of the of a research lab at the Wildlife Conservation Society. He's famous for his bathysphere. He was the first person, and I think this is in the early 1920s. He took the deepest dive in the ocean, unassisted man dive to 3,000 feet. Right, he became very famous for that. He would travel all over the world, the Eastern Pacific, the Galapagos, all over the Caribbean, Bermuda. He had a lab in Bermuda, and studying marine life from a research vessel. He was known for bringing a lot of artists on his vessel and would actually have them draw the images of the wildlife that they were seeing because they were not able to photograph many of them. So the artists, including many women artists and women scientists, were part of these expeditions that William Beebe hosted. You can see at the bottom here, there's a book called the Arcturus Adventure. If you're a reader and you're really interested in learning a little bit about New York history and our local ecology, in here, William Beebe tells a story about what he called the Hudson Gorge. We call it the Hudson Canyon. He called it the Hudson Gorge. And on a trip coming back from Galapagos around 1925, he stopped at the canyon and spent 4 days collecting samples and drawing critters that were there. Bizarre critters like wolffishes and eels and sharks and all kinds of things. You can see one of the sharks that he collected on the deck of the boat. If you're interested in learning about this, the New York Times had, you can get a microfiche copy of the New York Times article that you see on the bottom here that talks all about that expedition. And William Beebe's right was a popularist. He was a good scientist, but he also played an important role in telling people about the kind of research, the public, about the research he was doing. And he wrote many, many books, many articles about his adventure. And the New York Times actually published something like 35 different pieces about his work at the time. I would argue that the New York public probably knew a bit more about the Hudson Canyon then than they do today. If I go into a class and or into a room and I'm giving a lecture in person, I would ask you to raise your hand if you'd heard of the Hudson Canyon. And probably I'd say less than 5% of anybody there in the room has heard of it. I don't blame those folks. I, too, before I actually really started working locally on marine conservation, had not really heard of the Hudson Canyon. And so part of our mission as part of the New York Seascape and New York Aquarium is to actually tell the story of the canyon. And Beebe is a great example of how someone popularizes and got the public to appreciate what was right here in our backyard. And he has some amazing quotes about, you know, just being this 60 miles from New York City, how wild it was and how diverse these waters are. So here are just a couple of images of some of the wildlife there. You know, birds are on the surface, feeding off of the surface, all kinds of microorganisms there. There are wild fishes down there that can have light, have to create their own light because the canyon is so deep, the light will not penetrate it, right? So only on the upper feet of the, like maybe 200 to 600 feet is actually light penetrate. Squid are one of the most important fisheries out there, scallops, weird creatures like wolffishes and importantly, cold water corals. There are coral ecosystems and coral communities all up and down the canyons along the eastern seaboard that are really important structurally at the bottom of the ocean to create habitat for other creatures like octopus and bottom dwelling sharks and mussels and things like that. So from the surface all the way down to the bottom, there's just an amazing diversity of life. It's why we call it an ecological gem, right? Because there's so much life there. So in 2006, after establishing the program, the York Seascape program, in 2016, we decided that this was a place worthy of greater conservation protection. Just like the Grand Canyon deserved protection as a national park, we thought this ocean habitat in our backyard deserved protection. And we nominated it as a national marine sanctuary. All right. This is a process that's run by the agency that oversees our fisheries and our weather. We call them NOAA, National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Agency, or administration. And we petitioned them to actually turn this area into a sanctuary. Now, the National Marine Sanctuary system is not new. It's been around for, I think we're celebrating their 50th year? How old are we? Yeah, about 50th year anniversary this year. And we currently have about 15 national marine sanctuaries along off in New York waters, all the way out to, you know, the Hawaiian Islands and from Olympic Peninsula into the Gulf. We don't have any national treasure protected, marine treasure protected here in our local waters. We decided the Hudson Canyon would be one of those places. Now, a national marine sanctuaries are set aside as a public resource. They're multi-use. They have, in many places, fishing occurs. It's not like it's a wilderness area that we fence and close off to the public. It's meant to be a resource of ecological significance that we protect for multiple uses and for in perpetuity, right? That's the goal, right? So in putting together this nomination package, and you can go online, and it was a 25-page letter, we had to address the criteria that a nomination for a sanctuary must meet. And so, I'm sorry, this is a little bit, you can't quite see the last thing there, but it has to be it has to have ecological significance, but it also should have cultural and historical significance. What else happened there? Are there shipwrecks there? Was it used by indigenous people? You know, is it currently historically important? It also can have economic use. In our case, the Hudson Canyon is a really important area for fishing. In both commercial and recreational fisheries are very active in the canyon because it is so ecologically diverse. The public has to be able to get benefit from it. We think about that in terms of things like education, science, non-extractive uses like a wildlife viewing, right? That provides for research opportunities and as I mentioned, educational opportunities. So our initial nomination letter addressed all of these questions. And in 2017, the government, NOAA, the agency came back and said, we agree with you. We do think that this is a very important area of national, deserving national protection, right? Great ecological significance. And so I'll go back a second. And so we proceeded to then build support, right? So to get that support, it is establishing a national marine sanctuary is a very public process. It is something where we must show grassroots support, stakeholder support, everything from, you know, a local student to the governor of the state, or, you know, all the agencies, people who use it for various uses, whether, you know, it's for research, et cetera. We had to show support. And so in doing so, we were actually able to generate like 17,000 comments, I think, that supported that. And I'm just going to, let's see, I'm going to just go ahead just a second and just give you an idea. We were actually, we worked with visitors at the aquarium and had students writing postcards and telling the government why they thought it was so important, right? And with that, the following year, in 2017, our nomination was put into what's called the sanctuary inventory. It is sort of a holding bin for all the places that then has to go through another public process of designation before it actually can be established as a sanctuary, right? Our nomination has been sitting in the inventory since 2016. It can only stay there for 5 years, okay, before you'd have to go through the whole nomination process again. But, and that would have brought, that brought us up to February 2022, right? Just a last month. Fortunately, we were asked to please make the case again, update the information, make the case again for why we think this is a special place. And we put together another very large document full of information. It's also available publicly on their website. You'll learn even more about the canyon. And with that, the government decided this really continues to be a special place. We're going to keep the nomination in our inventory. That is a big deal for us because now we can now push to start having a nomination process that actually invites the public, I'm sorry, a designation process. The next step is to try to have it designated. Now, part of what we do besides raising awareness, et cetera, is to try to document why this area is so important. And so I just wanted to give you a little bit, I see this is cut off, but just a little bit of a sense of the work that we're doing out there in the canyon to help continue to make the case for why we should be protecting it. We do, as I mentioned earlier, a bunch of shark research, tagging sharks. In this case, it's a mako shark with an acoustic tag, right? I mean, sorry, with a satellite tag. That satellite tag that sits on the back of the fin of this shark, every time the shark comes to the surface, it tells us where it's going, where it is, because it's beaming up its location to an orbiting satellite. And with that information, we can tell here what that shark has done. And I'm not sure if this is legible enough for you, but basically, this is a shark that we tagged right off in the canyon. And then we show it demonstrates itself, the movements up and down along the edge of the continental shelf, and here how important it is using the canyon, right? So we want a sanctuary nomination, a designation would allow us to continue to do this work. It would bring federal dollars to other local universities and researchers to continue to document what's here. Because despite the fact that it's the largest canyon along the eastern seaboard, we actually don't know that much about it, okay? We know that it's important. A sanctuary is multiple use. There's a lot of shipping that goes on across the canyon, commercial fishing. It's a mecca for recreational fishermen, fishermen who like big game fishing, like for tunas, swordfish, sharks. It's a very important area. WCS is recommending as part of our nomination package that fishing be allowed to continue in the sanctuary, but also that it gets managed by the agency. The National Marine Fisheries Service manages the fisheries instead of the sanctuary program, right? Because as long as it's sustainable fishing, we think it can continue to have a place out there. And then, of course, other things that it can be help can use in other economic opportunities are to expand offshore wildlife observing. So there are now already cruises that go out there to, you can go on a boat to bird watch, you can go out there to whale watch. We see all this as an important role that a sanctuary in Hudson would play. But one of the things we are most concerned about, and one of the main reasons we actually initiated the nomination and designation for a sanctuary, is we're very concerned about development of oil and gas off our shoreline, right? Earlier surveys, there was some survey work done by the government to map the entire seacoast, including Hudson Canyon. And what they observed was that there were a lot of places where there were what we call methane seeps. That is where methane gas was bubbling up. And that's an indicator that there's oil and gas below the surface, just like in the Gulf of Mexico, that could be tapped. We're very concerned about any exploitation of oil and gas off our waters. Any kind of spill would devastate the wildlife here, tourism, fishing, etc. And so that was one of the main motivations we had for nominating the sanctuary, because sanctuaries preclude in perpetuity development of oil and gas off, you know, in those waters. All right. So that was one of our main motivations. I see that this did not translate very well into this slide show, but so where we are at, we have a nomination that's still sitting in the inventory. The next stage is designation. National Marine Sanctuary nomination designation, as I mentioned, is a very much a public process, needs strong stakeholder support. So we are hoping that the next step that the government will take, that NOAA will take, will be to advance our nomination to a designation process. This is where the scientists and stakeholders and the government weighs in on should this actually be a sanctuary, and begins all the hard work of documenting the benefits, the costs, setting up advisory panels, etc. And then so it's a 2 to 5 year process that ultimately would end up, if all goes well, with a designation, right, in 2 to 5 years. And with that would be the development of a local office where we can congregate people and help celebrate and advertise and engage people in canyon protection, visitation, use, etc. But right now we are at this designation phase. We're hoping that we will be able to, if the government in the near future says we are going to move this forward to a designation, we're going to start the process all over again of building public support. So back in 2016 in the nomination, we actually generated over 17,000 stakeholders, messages from the public supporting the Canyon nomination. We want to do that again for designation, including with our students, with people like you, with the general public, because we think that this is really a worthwhile way to say, our waters count, our wildlife count. The people here who live here in New York care about our ocean and want a legacy for now and for future generations. And so we've been developing a lot of different outreach tools. Like you can go on our website and you can see these kinds of posters that provide the public and students with, you know, some general ideas about what the canyon is and why it's so important. And I'm going to finish up maybe to give us a little bit more, give us a few minutes where if we wanted to have time for some questions, et cetera, I can talk to you a little bit more about it. But what I want to do is invite you to come learn more. We can send you links to websites if you're really curious to some of these massive documents we put together to promote the canyon. But we, as we said, we also have fact sheets, et cetera, that you can share with others. The more we talk about this place, the more we generate, the more concerns we have about our local water, the more we can build stewardship, right? So if you wanted to learn more, we would also like to invite you to come to the aquarium, right? So in 2018, the New York Aquarium in Coney Island, which you see here, opened up this new exhibit called Ocean Wonders Sharks. And this is largely an exhibit space about sharks, but also a way for us to tell about all the amazing wildlife in our waters. So we have different galleries and different tanks in there that tell New Yorkers about why New York is special, right? Why the New York Seascape is so special, and give people an opportunity to understand the work we're doing and then also to take action to help become stewards of the sanctuary, right? So if in this particular exhibit space, we have a big room. It's really so inspiring, especially, I mean, it's great when kids are there and are squealing and squeaking about what they're seeing in this giant tank. But it can also be a very, if you go on off time, it's a very quiet and beautiful place. It's called a canyon's edge. And in here, you get a sense for what it would be like to be in the Hudson Canyon, right? We don't have photographs in there. We can't photograph the canyon walls and all the life that is there. But this gives you an idea what it's about. And we also have, as I mentioned earlier, William Beebe was one of the first to describe the Hudson Gorge. This is his actual bathysphere. It's at the entrance to the aquarium. You can go see it, touch it. He didn't use it in the Hudson Gorge, but he did use it in many other places of the world. Yet he was, you know, one of the people who inspired the public to actually be aware of it and even to this day, hopefully protect it. So I think with that, I am going to say thank you. And I am happy to take questions or continue the conversation however you would like. Can't hear you. Lynn, you're on mute.
Thanks. Sorry about that. I had to mute the sirens outside. Thank you so much, Mary. That was fabulous. I feel like I have learned so much and maybe we'll even remember a lot of it. And, you know, like you mentioned, so many of us really don't give a lot of thought to what's out there under the water.
Yep.
And I love the seascape map that your organization produced that just gives you a sense of the variety of wildlife.
That's right.
Aquatic wildlife. And we do have an excellent question. Are there efforts to remove that dam that you mentioned that is blocking the movement of fish and wildlife?
Right. So dams are probably one of the biggest impediments to coastal, to wildlife, and not only just fish, but other species as well, turtles that you depend on the water, invertebrates, to getting in, moving in and out of up and down these river corridors, right? We have thousands of dams along in this country. In New York alone, we have something like 5,000 large dams. Mm-hmm. And almost all of our streams and rivers along Long Island, up the Hudson River, are blocked by dams. So we know what dams, why we have dams, right? They were either used to create water bodies for sources of fresh water, or to generate energy for mills, to make wool or to grind grain or whatever it might be. There are dams all over this country, all over New York, all over New York City. In the Bronx River, that dam was built over 300 years ago. That is the largest dam on the Bronx River. There are reasons why we take out dams. They get old. Right. After 50 years, they have to be permitted by the government. After 50 years, those licenses and permits have to be renewed for safety reasons. And in some cases, taking out a dam is a lot less expensive than rebuilding a dam or, you know, shoring up a dam. And so there's movements now all over the country to take these dams out for river connectivity and for safety, human safety. But there are places where it's hard to take out a dam. In that particular dam, probably will not be removed in the foreseeable future. But what we have done to help reconnect the river is the New York City Department of Parks, as well as Bronx River Alliance, with support from and help from the Wildlife Conservation Society and federal agencies, actually put in a fish pass. So I don't have a picture of a fish pass here. But basically what it does is it's a long aluminum tunnel that connects the bottom of the dam to the top of the dam and has like structure, sort of like little steps inside the passage that fish can actually jump up and go up to that habitat. So we know that baby eels who come in at this size and then grow to this size in the Bronx River, you can't even see, bigger than my picture here, over 4 feet, go into that system and grow up in there. They use the fish pass and the eel pass to get up there. So there's that dam probably won't be removed, but there is interest on the part of the city upriver in the Bronx River, in the Botanical Garden, and the 5 additional dams north of there in the Bronx and Westchester. There is interest in trying to either remove those dams or to add more fish passage so that we can open up more habitat for wildlife. And that wildlife, the fish are important, not just for the fish itself, but birds, beavers, other things. They move energy and resources from the ocean to the fresh water and back again. So they're really important conveyors of nutrients and energy. So we're trying to make the place, make New York, more hospitable to all kinds of life.
Well, that seems like pretty good news on that front.
Yes.
I did check the Queen's Library catalog, and we have several books by William Beebe, including Arcturus Adventure. So any of our viewers out there, if you want to learn more about him and his work, please check out those books. You can even request them so they'll be ready for you to pick up when you come by.
And he did a lot of popular writing, too. Besides just the books, there are all kinds of articles that are probably in your microfiche or in your collections that are all popular. He wrote comic books, for example, and things like that, because he really wanted to connect New Yorkers to what he was learning. So he's fascinating.
And so I was wondering, he went down in the bathysphere. Have there been any more recent scientists who have taken submersibles down to explore the canyon?
Yes, there have. And I would like to say we need more, right? We need more. It's a big place and we don't do it often enough. There are many, many, many questions that need to be answered. But the agency that does our fisheries and weather also has an ocean exploration arm that takes very large submersibles and cameras all over the world and dives into these maps and dives into these deep canyons, taking photographs, using really cutting edge technology to study these places. So if you were to look up Hudson Canyon, you would see that there was in 2002, there was a major expedition that really started to get at this, tell us about these corals that were down there, which are now, by the way, protected from damaging fishing activities, and all kinds of things about the energy resources there, these deep sea corals, the fish that are there. There was that. And then even this past summer, it wasn't a dedicated expedition to the Hudson Canyon, but part of a larger expedition of the canyons to our north. They put down these amazing submersibles and were able to there's video online, there's photographs of animals living in the depths in the complete darkness. Their submersibles have light, so they bounce off and we can actually see these images of some of the wildlife down there, some of the animals down there. There's a lot of questions that still need to be answered. And so if we have a sanctuary designated, that helps to drive research dollars and interest both from the federal level all the way down to local students. All right. So that's part of the reason, we want to see this move forward.
And so you talked about the cold water corals. And of course, we hear so much about the tropical corals. And I have to say, I may have heard of cold water corals in the past, but I know next to nothing about them. Are they also threatened by the warming ocean waters?
Yes. So you may have heard them. If you haven't heard them as cold water corals, they're also called deep sea corals, right? They don't form big reefs like from the visiting the tropics or the Caribbean. They tend to be more like small clusters. The diversity isn't quite as large, but they are very important structures on the bottom and on the walls of the canyon because they create habitat, places for little fish and stuff to hide in. They are vulnerable just like tropical corals are, to temperature changes, et cetera. Now, one of the major concerns that we've had, and why we were so glad that a number of years ago, I think it was 2014, we were actually able to exclude damaging fishing operations in the deeper parts of the canyon, is because they're very easily destroyed by a passing trawl net or something like that. One, you know, if you think about clear cutting in a forest, similar to that, a net dragged along these very fragile corals totally flattens them. These coral systems take thousands of years to generate. What's down there now, you know, has been around for thousands of years. So if we damage them with fishing gear, it's going to be a very long time before they come back. We're just now beginning to understand how climate change and warming oceans are going to affect deep sea ecosystems. We know much more about what's going to happen at the surface. And what we know in New York is that we are already seeing shifts of species, whether it's lobsters, black sea bass. We are now documenting movement of fish that used to use our waters northward and things from the south coming into our waters. Things are changing very, very rapidly, making it very hard to manage and to know, you know, how it's going to change. Understanding the impacts of that climate change on the ocean, it's hard to know, but we also know that they're affected by plastic pollution, right? There's all the plastics that wash out, whether it's microplastics or plastic bags. Images from the deep sea canyon I've seen where there are plastic bags wrapped around these corals, right? So there are a lot of things we can do to help protect them, including reducing our plastic use, right? At least single-use plastic use and taking care of our trash, et cetera. So they're very much at risk.
I'm so glad you brought up the plastic problem, because that is something that I think all of us need to be more aware of and thinking about from day to day. And consumables that are all around us that are just single use items, plastics and other things, but those plastics have a long life after we have used them.
That is so true. And that's one of the reasons, you know, we know that this is a major threat to ocean wildlife, including here in New York. It's one of the reasons why the aquarium and WCS has actually phased out the use of things like straws and other kinds of single use, you know, cup plastic covers on cups and other single use plastics, because we don't want to be contributing to, you know, we're teaching people about this. We don't want to be contributing to the problem ourselves. And we've actually were able to help get New York City to, you know, basically stop the free distribution of straws at every venue. You could ask for a straw, you can get a straw now, but the idea is to really take small steps and maybe faster and bigger steps, hopefully, so that we can actually reduce the impact that we're having. And that is something that everybody here in New York can help with.
Well, this has just been so wonderful. Maybe you would finish off with telling us the hours of the aquarium. And I would note that you can get to the aquarium on public transportation and you don't have to find a parking place. And you do your little bit for the environment by using public transportation.
That's right. That you can stop directly across the street from the aquarium. It's literally a 1 minute, 2 minute walk into the front entrance. So the aquarium is open 7 days a week, all year long, except mostly during inclement weather, right? Hours will change depending on the season. I think as the summer approaches, we're open like from 10 until 5 or 6. We're right on top of the boardwalk, and now with some of this new structure, you can actually see the ocean from the aquarium. Before that, Ocean Wonder Sharks exhibit was built, you wouldn't really know that we were just on the water's edge. But now you can see the ocean and the resources that we're trying to protect. And I will tell you that in the next few months, we're having a new reopening, a grand reopening. A lot of the exhibit spaces that were damaged by Hurricane Sandy have been rebuilt. We're talking about climate change in some of them, in addition to why New York waters are absolutely amazing and why we need your stewardship to help protect it. So I really encourage you, come see us, come. It's a little bit easier now. COVID restrictions have lightened, still be safe, but come learn about our local waters and help us protect them.
Including the second that, I haven't been there for quite a while and I have not seen the new shark exhibit, which I have heard is fabulous.
It is. It's inspiring. It is.
So I want to finish up by another huge thank you to Mary, and I hope we'll have you back, and we'll find out what the progress is on the preservation designation for the Hudson Canyon. And please like and share this video. It will be archived on our YouTube channel. And join us next week, March 26th at 2 p.m., for a program about birding in the parks along our shore, our connection with the water in Hunter's Point. And we'll have some of our friends from the conservancy there in Hunter's Point.
And know in your waters, there are lots and lots of fish right off Hunter's Point, including sharks and eels and alewife and all these wonderful creatures. Remember that when you go to the water's edge.
I think that's an excellent point to think about. It's not just that kind of dark looking water there. There is a whole city underneath there.
That's right. The city that never sleeps. The sea that never sleeps.
Well, I'm going to finish up by recognizing our funders again. These programs are made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by the City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. And I hope we'll see you next week. And thank you again, Mary. Everybody have a wonderful weekend.
And thank you, Lynn and Queens Library and everybody. Have a good day.